conferences on virtual reality. And, you know, on one level you have the gung-ho technocrats who just see this as the greatest form of entertainment ever. But it does raise certain fairly profound questions. I mean, if you can put on a glove and some iPhones and go into a synthetic world, let's say a lavishly furnished mansion on a hill, but in that mansion a painting hangs over the fireplace, and by pointing your finger at the painting, you go through it and break through onto a pine-dotted plain with a fountain in the center of it. And then by going to that fountain and walking through it, emerge back in the kitchen of the mansion. You know, where does reality begin and end? And how can we at this moment satisfy ourselves that we are not in some kind of solid state matrix of some sort? How can we satisfy ourselves that this is not itself a simulacrum? And the answer is you can't. We only assume it isn't, because that's called Occam's razor. You all know what Occam's razor is, right? It's the idea that hypotheses should not be multiplied without necessity. The simple way of saying that is the simplest idea should always be preferred. But notice that this will lead you into deep error in most human situations. If you prefer the simplest explanation for what's going on, you'll never understand what's going on. I mean, you see two people and they're falling in love. If you assume they're falling in love because they like each other, you're probably missing the fact that one just inherited $10 million and the other is a rat. And, you know, one was abused as a child and the other is able to manipulate people all over the map. So Occam's razor is fine in the formulation of physical theory, but it doesn't take us far in understanding human motivation. What the psychedelics seem to me to argue for is that reality is not reality. There may be no reality, but certainly this is not it. This is some kind of highly provisional, culturally sanctioned hallucination that we are all participating in. And whatever it is, it yields ultimately to non-entity. I mean, our realities are sustained by our being. And from looking at what happens to other people, we know that eventually you get laid into the cold, cold ground. And then what is your reality worth? So reality, whatever it is temporary and yields to non-existence. That seems to be the primary ground of being. Yeah, over here.
Well, just in putting out something that's a question to be explored as the week goes on, I mean, I've had that experience of, you know, quote-unquote reality being this very subjective thing. My question is, even if it's not real, how could we use that fact to create a reality that's more enjoyable? When it occurred to me was, you talked about these Amazonian tribes and how, you know, what's happening on Wall Street isn't real there. Yet, you know, at some point, that whole seemingly infinite forest could be cut out from under them because of what's happening on Wall Street. So I'm interested in how looking at this sense of reality not being real, how that all plays out with one reality intruding on another.
Well, I think that what it points us toward, and this is where modern philosophy in large measure has gone, is realizing that the primacy of language, that it's up until fairly recently, people have accepted the idea that you're born into the world and that's the world, and then you make the best of it. It's the hand you've been dealt. But what they didn't understand was that this is a card game where you never have to show your hand. So you can claim to be holding eight aces. You can claim any damn thing you want. Reality is made out of language. Some people understand this and use it to bully the rest of us. I mean, we think, you know, you have to show your cards, and they know that you just claim to have aces and eights, and everybody gets out of your way. So, as a culture, what we have to do is, and I'm definitely not big on this whole French thing, but nevertheless, there is something to be said for this deconstructionist method. We have to get down to the bedrock of reality, which appears to be words, means, and ideas, and then build back up from that. We can, otherwise, what we get is the momentum of past error. We think of the people in the past as tremendously naive relative to ourselves, but it's their intellectual world that we're living in, because they thought up all this stuff. And then we are acting out the consequences of it. How can we take control of the reality-creating machinery and then direct it in a way we want to go? No culture on earth has ever done this, or even conceived of the idea, so far as I can tell. There's a lot of fun poked at feminism for its preference for words like chairperson and stuff like that. And these examples seem somewhat trivial. But in fact, the effort to reconstruct the language is very genuine, because thought can't go where the roads of language have not been built. So you decide where you want to go, and then you build a linguistic path there. This whole thing with the psychedelic experience, the way cultures lose touch with it is by not being able to say anything about it, you know? And then it eventually gets so unsayable that if you start babbling about it, they throw a net over you. And say, oh, well, he became schizophrenic. They had serious delusions, had to be locked up, didn't understand that the universe is, a half sphere on the back of a turtle being carried by a dwarf, or whatever the sanctioned cultural reality is. Our political dilemma and our cultural dilemma is a linguistic dilemma. And we need to take hold of language and build it consciously. Now, so far, the only people who have understood this very thoroughly have been bad people, fascists, and other people with some hideous agenda that they wanted to displace the ordinary, haphazard way of doing cultural business with. But it is not intrinsically compromised. It's simply that the sly among us figured this out ahead of all the rest of us. But we can learn from them and can begin to sanction realities that never existed before. I mean, you've probably all heard me talk about memes and how what the reason I teach, the reason I write, the reason we all get together is because we're trying to launch new memes. You all know what a meme is, right? A meme is the smallest unit. This is how I define it. Somebody told me recently, you define it wrong. It's all right. My definition is better. A meme is the smallest unit of an idea, in the same way that a gene is the smallest unit of organismic existence. So the meme of Marxism is made up of sub-memes of class struggle and return of the means of production to the workers and so forth and so on. These are Marxist memes.
So I don't understand why this, you're kind of getting under the point that it's language-based. Why can't this meme be visual?
Well, I define language so broadly that it can be visual. I mean, what it is it's the signifier for cognitive activity. And I don't want to get off into this kind of linguistic vocabulary about this stuff. But language means dance, sculpture, painting, poetry, song. It means cognitive activity. I mean, this is the glory of our species. This is what we do so much better than whoever's in second place. I mean, I guess the gorillas and the dolphins are a mile and a half behind doing whatever they're doing. But I just don't buy the notion that there is any other species on this planet, with the possible exception of mushrooms, that is involved in this language-making enterprise in quite the way we are. And it's how we escaped the iron constraints of organic existence. Culture is a kind of environment that we have learned how to interpose between ourselves and whatever is really out there. And we don't know what it was, because we invented culture 50,000 years ago and nobody's seen anything else since. But there was something there that was so frightening and so alarming to us that we invented culture as a membrane that we would place between ourselves and it. And then there have been other membranes invented since. Urbanization. Let's all crowd into cities and jabber to each other. That will hold it even more at bay. And so forth and so on. I mean, we really behave as though we fear something tremendously toxic or something which has a dissolving force over our being that lies beyond the frontier of language. And this relates to the ego. The ego is this cultural invention that we have created. People don't need egos. I mean, you need one in this culture because everybody else has one, and so you have to use yours to navigate through it. But it's not a necessary concomitant to being human. We could operate without them. But somehow we became traumatized by the experience of raw, unlanguaged nature, and we created this strategy. And it's no different than, you know, I mean, some creatures create nests underground, and some creatures coat themselves in toxic slime. We also did that, by the way, because there's something that has to be held back and suppressed that's very alarming.
It seems to me that on one point you're saying that, you know, we're way ahead of the dolphins because we've created this linguistic-based, thing. And on the other hand, I see it as, you've also just said that we've created this linguistic-based hallucination that's isolated us from a perceptual-based, I hesitate to use the word reality, but whatever you want to call it. And so why is this culture an improvement?
Well, I'm not saying it's an improvement. It's an experiment of some sort. No other creature ever took this particular tack. Now, evolution seems to have its own set of values. What evolution is seeking to maximize is expression of the individual genome. In other words, there are two ways that a species can be successful. It can either evolve into an unoccupied niche of some sort that it then can tenaciously take hold of, or it evolves strategies for generalizing its existence so that it can occupy all sorts of niches. And this is what we've done. And when you look at the two possibilities, you see that creatures which follow the maximize adaptation to a single niche strategy usually become blocked. Cockroaches are a good example. Evolutionarily, we could say that they are tremendously successful, but all they do is persist. They haven't modified or changed themselves in 150 million years.
By your definition, if there's more cockroach genes out there than human genes, they're more successful than us.
Well, not my definition, but the definition of biology. And cockroaches are always held up as this tremendously successful evolutionary adaptation. We have set out on a different course, and it's a course of continual redefinition. We can retool our culture very quickly. We have thrown away the mechanisms of genetic change and natural selection through modification of mutation, which was very, very slow and apparently a random walk. It didn't have any kind of telos. But cultures can actually set up goals and move toward them. Very large and unlikely goals. I mean, like the Third Reich, their decision that it would be a good idea to eliminate Jews from Central Europe. I mean, this is a crazy idea. It would never happen. Nothing like that would ever happen in a situation of organic evolution. But in a situation of cultural evolution, the idea becomes the guiding image for the society, and then outrageous things are done, and the consequences of that are played out. I would like to think that that we have not escaped from the yoke, the controlling yoke of nature. In other words, we aren't off on some demonic tear where we are just like evil incarnate, but that actually nature requires a species such as ourselves to basically to harness energy. We are on a higher level doing what the mitochondria did in the abiotic oceans of the earth 1 billion years ago. We're energy storage and release mechanisms sanctioned by nature for some purpose which will be visible somewhere downstream in the flow of time, but which is opaque to us. For us, history seems a kind of a nightmare, but it must, I think, have a happy ending, or it would never have been allowed to happen in the first place. I just don't think that a monkey species had the wherewithal to evade the mechanisms of control and constraint that guide and direct everything on the planet. There is a purpose to history. And, you know, I don't want to go into it tonight, but as many of you know, I've spent a lot of time thinking about this, trying to figure out something good about the human race, something that can be said of us that will redeem the sins that we have visited upon the planet. And it isn't easy, but some of our best people are working on it. You know what I mean?
If in fact part of what we are is the unveilment of the world or nature, as you're referring to now.
Well, maybe what's going on is that nature, you see, we as individuals can remember the past and model the future. But it may be that nature operates in an entirely different way. This harks back to our discussion of Platonism. Nature may have a kind of viewpoint in eternity. Nature may actually see what needs to be done and can plan on a scale of 1 million or 100 million years so that, well, this is slightly afield, but it keeps coming up, so it's worth talking about. Every body in the solar system, all of the inner planets, all of their moons, all of the solid bodies that orbit around the gas giants in the outer solar system, every piece of rock in the entire solar system has just been hammered to pieces by asteroid and planetesimal infall. And we prefer not to think about this. As recently as last January, and what's called an Apollo asteroid crossed within a half lunar distance of the Earth. This is hair-raisingly close. And there's this crater out in Arizona. It's only 50,000 years old, Whatever came down there was only about 30 feet across, and everything within 800 miles died instantly when that thing came down. There's a scar on the Canadian Shield larger than the crater Copernicus on the moon. Now, this crater is over 1.5 billion years old. The point being, the universe may be a fantastically chaotic and dangerous place. And so our cheerful model of what biology is about is that, you know, we've evolved over 1.5 billion years, and we have 1 billion years more, and there's no hurry, and it's all fine, and man has thousands of years to work out the problems of civilization and so forth and so on. But it may actually be that nature senses some kind of danger, and that a species like ourselves is a response to this danger. Our most astonishing feat as a species to date, besides language, I think, is that we can, though we are made of mush, we can summon to the deserts of this planet the light which burns at the center of the stars themselves. Not bad for anthropoid apes. I mean, granted, as soon as we do this, we then plot and scheme on how to bring it down on the heads of our enemies. That's not our noblest trait. But the fact that we could go into matter and wrest a secret like atomic fusion from it and then carry that out is astonishing. And it may be that history, which lasts in the technical phase 25,000 years, something like that. I mean, if you go back just 15,000 years, it's a pretty bare wire scene. So the whole thing is a wink of an eye, you know, a geological instant from somebody getting the idea that you could flake flint off a core to the idea that you could send a starship to Zeta Reticuli, you know, 25,000 years to do that. And so I think that we have a destiny, and probably our destiny is to save the planet. And, you know, it would be the final irony if we spent a huge amount of time hammering on each other to get rid of nuclear weapons and stop cutting the rainforests and stuff like that. And then one of these planetesimals contacted the Earth and we all died instantly. This thing that passed by at a half lunar distance in January, it was not detected until 5 days later. Had it actually impacted the Earth, you would never have known what hit you. This thing which killed the dinosaurs 65 million years ago, it raised a tidal wave 5 miles high that moved out from the impact point at 5 times the speed of sound. Can you picture a tidal wave 5 miles high moving at Mach 5? I mean, we're talking major smush here. And
Is that a good curl?
And the evidence is there that this happens, that these things are not rare, that it will happen again. I mean, if you take a long enough time span, they say it's a certainty. But take still, it to the bank.
But still the Earth survives. So when you say
It survived. This thing which killed the dinosaurs, nothing larger than a chicken walked away from it. On this planet, nothing larger than a chicken. Okay, so that's the bad news. The good news is the flowering plants evolved in the wake of that catastrophe. The mammals got their purchase. They were egg-stealing weasels up till that point. And then this opened up an opportunity for them to rush in and exfoliate all kinds of different forms. The Earth has faced outrageous crises in its history. At a very distant point in the history of the Earth, anaerobic life dominated the Earth. And then it began to produce oxygen as a toxic byproduct. Oxygen was as toxic to the early life forms on Earth as plutonium is to us. And yet, strategies were evolved, and this huge problem was gone around, and we then are the result of this. So, yes, there is no moral, there is finally no moral judgment. There's just, you know, shit happens. That seems to be the rule, and then you can think it's good or bad or indifferent. But that's not the human point of view. The human point of view is that we have something very precious here that we want to conserve, that we want to carry through any conceivable catastrophe. And so, you know, technology may be a strategy for this. This is why it's very important for us to think about reality on different levels. I started out by talking about philosophical reality, something for, you know, elderly people to discuss in book-lined parlors. But there's also stuff like, what is the reality of our circumstance in this star swarm, in this galaxy? Are we safe or are we imperiled? What should we be doing? Is it okay to, should we be worrying about saving the rainforests, or is that preposterous in the light of what we're facing? And how can we know? What is to be done? The Tolstoyan question. What is to be done? You can't begin to answer that question until you have some notion of what reality is. And at this stage in trying to understand what reality is, all processes seem to me to be deconstructive. We need to take apart our languages, our cultural assumptions, the geological history of this planet, the biological history, the astrophysical nature, the structures in which we're embedded in. We need to awaken to our true circumstance. The dreams that culture gives us, that we should be good Nazis or good Buddhists or good Witoto, or these are just illusions that are temporary delusions which make possible the business of culture. But something now is happening that is different. We are becoming a global civilization. Power is being given into our hands that is truly power on a cosmic scale. I mean, what difference did it make when bronze-tipped spears were the heaviest thing anybody could bring to bear on any problem? But once you can blow the earth apart, like putting a stick of dynamite in a rotten apple, then you actually become actors on a cosmic scale. And this is the situation in which we find ourselves. This is why there's a certain urgency, I think, because I totally disagree with people who think that human history, you know, can be seen wandering aimlessly into the millennia of the future with faster spacecraft and better packaged foods and more effective forms of psychotherapy and so forth. I mean, this seems to me preposterous. Obviously, human history is some kind of self-limiting process that is seeking to maximize something. And if you look over what we've been doing, it seems like what we're trying to maximize is an ability to release energy. Well, there may be more exotic ways to release energy than thermonuclear fusion, but thermonuclear fusion is a huge leap in the order of magnitude of the kind of energy that you can release. I mean, before nuclear fusion, the biggest explosion, the biggest release of energy that anybody could create was some kind of conventional bomb of some sort, which didn't amount to zip except in the place where it happened to be dropped. Nuclear weapons are a whole other thing. I mean, all our dreams, all our religious fantasies about the end of the world, that was harmless enough stuff when all we could do is split each other's heads open. Well, okay, so that's perhaps enough about the point of view of straight science, because I doubt there are very many people in this room who are actually practice that kind of science. A point that should be made about reality that comes slightly closer to the experience of each of us is, for society to work for reality, always in quotes, to work, we have to assume that we are sharing the same reality. And there are different levels on which this assumption operates. For instance, many of you have heard me talk about the slippery vicissitudes of language, that in fact we are communicating, we are most in agreement when we are silent with each other, because then our assumptions about how we're in agreement are able to fully unfurl themselves. But all it takes is somebody breaking that silence and stating the contents of their mind for the assumption of our shared reality to completely collapse upon us. Because it turns out, you know, I think it's one way, you think it's another, I believe we're doing X, you think we're doing Y, I think we're serving so-and-so, and you think we're serving somebody else. And this is why, I think great relationships are built in silence, because then nobody ever finds out what's really going on. Did you want to say something?
Yeah, when you're talking about science, are you talking about science, the kind of science where in order for it to be science, you have to repeat, in a certain situation, it has to be repeated and you have to get the same response so that that proves out to be a truth?
That's a good definition of science.
So that when you're talking about reality in the moment, that never proves out true, because if you're in that artistic moment, then you never get a repetition. You're getting a synchronicity where your reality is in tune with a flow that the words I use is like miraculous. The things start, people start showing up when I need them to chop chop, and it's when I let go of my ego and my need for a specific thing that flow starts to happen. And in a scientific world, you need that the same thing repeated several times in order to get it to be a truth.
That's right. I mean, a good definition of science, not one that any scientist would be comfortable with. I mean, they think they're doing God's work or something. But the fact of the matter is, what science is the study of those phenomena so crude that return to initial conditions will cause the phenomenon to repeat itself. Well, if you think about your own life, there's nothing like that in your own life. Love affairs, careers, disappointments, nothing that we experience as human beings has that quality. So science, this is the problem with science, is that in the pursuit of explanation, it has cut itself off absolutely from making sense of anything in our own lives. That's why in efforts by science to move into the domains of our own lives have not been happy. Sciences like psychology and sociology are pseudosciences, as far as I'm concerned, because the objects they seek to explicate, personalities in one case and human group interaction in another, are not scientific phenomena because they don't fall under the rubric of restoration of initial conditions allows the same situation to unfold. But I want to point out, go further than this. Well, first of all, let me say one more thing about that.
Maybe what you just said is not quite true, because if you were able to provide the whole set of same initial conditions, which is impossible to provide. Mm-hmm. But if you are able to provide exactly the same circumstances, there is a chance that may happen. The problem is that you are not able to understand what all the initial conditions are.
No, I think that since the invention of the probability calculus, that's not even believed anymore. In other words, the idea used to be that if you think of the universal history as a film, that if you ran it back to the beginning and then hit the start button again, everything will happen exactly like it happened before, and I will be born in poor but humble circumstances in a Colorado mining town, and it will. But I think now the understanding is that only generally would the same things happen, and that even in orthodox science, probability allows for slight deviation from. So it isn't an absolute determinism.
Well, I don't believe that, because my feeling is that what we are just saying is that we don't understand what's happening, and the probability is just saying, more or less, I guess that it's going to be around there. I just have some idea of what's happening. But it's saying, I'm not understanding the process really well, and therefore I can guide you approximately where you're going.
So do you think that if we could return to the initial conditions of the Big Bang and have it happen again, that 5 billion years later, I would be sitting here with the same amount of change in my pocket as I have right now?
I don't believe that we could do that.
Well, you brought it up.
We could go back to the Big Bang and be back there. But what I'm saying is that the fact that you're saying that if you go back to the same initial conditions, then it's going to reproduce itself, that statement is not true. It's not true either.
The problem is there's only one set of initial conditions that are truly initial, which is the Big Bang. All other sets of initial conditions are embedded in some larger surround where everything has changed. I mean, for instance, if we say, we can never restore initial conditions. The planets have moved. The stars are older. How can we restore the initial conditions? Everything only happens once. And then it never repeats itself. But I'm plowing toward this thing. But I want to say one more thing. I'll subvert myself. That is, in order to do its work, science had to, and this happened with Descartes, it had to take the things that are most dear to us, colors, taste, feeling, tactility, and it defined those things as what it calls secondary qualities. Basically, this is a way of saying they're not important. None of that is important. And what is important are primary qualities: spin, velocity, angular momentum, charge. Strangely enough, things none of us have a very intuitive grasp of, nor do we ever encounter these things in any naked form. They're always embedded in matter. So science, in order to do its work, basically had to define the universe of feeling, emotionality, and immediacy as somehow peripheral, derivative, epiphenomenal, unimportant. And we all live with this legacy, unconsciously or consciously. You know, we are the victims of this kind of denigration of what we intuitively feel to be important, which is immediate experience. And immediate experience is not an object for scientific inquiry. Never has been, never will be. I mean, these pseudosciences fiddle with it a little bit, but the first thing they do when they study, for instance, human behavior, is they don't study. They set up an experimental situation, which is not like any human behavior you've ever dealt with before, like either, you know, looking at screens and pushing buttons or receiving electric shocks if you get right answers and stuff like that. I mean, how many times do we find ourselves in a situation where if we get a right answer, we avoid an electric shock? I mean, it's absurd. However, then, there is a further distancing from reality that takes place that is not to be laid at the feet of science, although to discuss it we have to use scientific terminology. And that is, it goes like this. We all assume that if we are... I just stated how what a great thing silence was for building shared assumptions. So if we are all silent and we look around us in this room, we do tend to make the assumption that we all see the same thing, that we are all sharing the experience of the room. But when you analyze perception, you discover a very weird thing about perception. For instance, let's take the primary sense in human beings, which is sight. We trust our eyes. We believe that it's that our eyes tell us something about immediate reality. However, if you analyze what sight is, what seeing is, it's that light reflected off surfaces pours into a sensory organ and then is transduced through a series of neurological transforms into an interiorized model of the immediate surround. The problem with this is that the light which enters my eyes is entirely mine. You don't get any of it. And the light which enters your eyes is entirely yours. Not a single photon is ever shared by two people. If it's my photon, it can't be yours, because photons can only be in a very discreetly defined area of space, in this case, in my retina. So everything I'm seeing is entirely opaque to you. Hidden, occult, and everything you're seeing is entirely opaque and hidden to me. We are truly prisoners of our unique perception. So it's a miracle that we can build models where we get any sort of shared consensus out of it at all.
Terence, may I say something?
Sure. You're driving the tape editor mad.
You can turn this around, because the twin slit, the twin photon experiment shows, in fact, that there's no way that a photon can be considered as an individual object. I mean, what the experiment demonstrates is that every photon fills the entire universe.
Well, it demonstrates it by the fiat of a fishy formula, don't you think?
No, I think it's...
well, why not?
How do you explain the interference pattern?
Well, I think that explaining it, it's not really explainable in the sense of, if you mean how do you reduce it to a linear logic, you don't. It's pretty mysterious.
Yeah. Well, it does. It does come out of a linear. I mean, it ends up you have to assume that the photon goes through both slits, and you get the interference pattern as a linear superposition of the... So it is, in a sense, linear. But what I would argue is, since a photon is not... a little particle. It's something else. I mean, at least one of its properties is that it fills the entire universe and can interfere. One could understand that we're all receiving, in fact, the same photon. Every photon that goes in my eye goes in everybody else's
eye. Well, but when you say it fills the entire universe, it fills some parts of the universe much more than others.
That's the probability.
Yes, and that's what gives it its particulate nature, is that it tends, it is technically everywhere, but it's only technically everywhere. In any practical sense, whenever we carry out a measurement on it, and seeing is a kind of collapse of this quantum vector, then it appears to be particulate.
That's absolutely right. We've only ever observed photons as but the effects we observe, like the interference pattern, is not particulate. You can't explain it in terms of...
That's right.
So even though that photon that goes through your eyes mostly goes through yours, and only a little bit goes through mine, you can't ignore the bit that goes through mine, because there are lots and lots of examples of...
But don't you think that the experiments which prove this kind of thing are depend on such a vast chain of assumptions that the experiment itself becomes highly questionable. I mean, first of all, the first assumption that's made that is absolutely outside the realm of proof is that mathematics has something to say about reality. And we could actually have spent the entire evening on this, except that it probably would clear the room of all but the most hardcore. But no one has ever shown why operations with numbers, which are, after all, entities only met with in the confines of the minds of anthropoid apes, should somehow have this overwhelming relationship to reality. What is the relationship of mathematics to what we call reality? Fact is, nobody knows. It's a deep mystery. Well, then when you talk about experiments, the assumptions, the hidden assumptions behind any experimentalist approach are usually so great that once made explicit, the experimental method is seen to be simply the servant of a formal theory and can't be seen to serve truth at all. Do you agree with that?
Yeah, I do. I mean, but that's what you end up facing, is the fact that it's our concepts that are creating the reality. And so even the assumption that there's a surface out there that's reflecting light is not an assumption that a physicist would make.
Because yeah, well,
in fact, if we made that assumption, we couldn't get anywhere. I mean, it just doesn't work.
That's right. I think the purpose of this evening is to show that reality is a naive concept and should probably be abandoned as quickly as possible.
Reality from the
what I hear is it's reality from a standpoint of physical explanations, which seem like red herrings in some way to me, is that if there's, speaking from sort of what would be a more spiritual viewpoint, that sort of the physical plane and things matter and everything falls out from more archetypical or something that has a less or more spiritual meaning, which I don't have so much a reality problem with.
That seems more real to you, this invisible dimension of eternal objects that are casting a lower dimensional shadow into the stream of time and giving rise to appearances.
Yeah, that's what you
meant in the day. Took the words right out of the Yeah, the experience.
Well, I think this is why Greek philosophy was able to do business so successfully, is that this seems intuitively true to most people. It's sort of like campfire philosophy. If you just sit down and try to figure it out, there's something in the human mind. I mean, I suppose it's self-referential if we call it archetypes, but there's something in the human mind that causes us to gravitate toward this Platonic point of view. The problem is, it's very naive, and the naivete of Platonism has never seemed to erode its success. I mean, it's been converting sophomores for 3,000 years almost, but in a way, the great victory of modern thinking, and I'm amazed to hear myself say this because I'm a Platonist through and through, but you have to be a modified Platonist or you will end up running up against impossible problems with it. For instance, you know, if these archetypes are eternal, well then what was there? If the archetype of the human love affair is eternal, then are we asked to believe that the archetype of the human love affair existed before the Big Bang? Did the law of gene segregation exist before the Big Bang? This is what Rupert's always at such pains to talk about. Natural laws. I mean, what is the status of these natural laws before the appearance of the universe? Is there a kind of hyperspace of eternity? And then why are these natural laws as they are? It seems much more economical and intuitively less problem fraught to assume that the so-called laws of nature are actually habits of nature that are changing through time as the universe evolves and changes. And I mean, I don't think it makes any sense to talk about the law of gene segregation before there was organic life. I mean, how could there be a law of gene segregation? I mean, it just gets too patched together as a theory, don't you think?
No, I think that you're introducing, those are loaded problems that you're, to talk about the Big Bang as itself, and the whole, time and et cetera.
Well, what do you think the status of these archetypes is? Do they require a universe, or are they there whether there is a universe of space, time, and matter?
I don't know.
Well, it seems that that's only a problem if you're thinking of time in a normal type of progression and normal types of causal relationships. You know, so it seems that's to refute the idea of an eternal archetype because of, do they exist before this?
So you want to substitute a Boolean logic here. Well, we could say, for instance, we could invert the causality of the universe and say that the Platonic objects exist at the end of time and that they cast their influence backwards through time. And we could even define an archetype as that class of objects whose casuistry runs counter to the ordinary arrow of time. I never thought of that before. It's probably fraught with epistemic peril, but somebody might want to work out the consequences of that. It's the idea, you see, that is now very hot in chaos theory, that there is an attractor rather than an impeller. That it isn't that there was a Big Bang and everything is moving out from the Big Bang and physics is the unraveling of the consequences of this initial improbability. It's rather the idea that there is a telos of some sort, a purpose that is drawing phenomena into some kind of concrescence that occurs not at the beginning of the causal process, but at its end. And I tend to lean toward that, but not in so hard a fashion that I would want to locate the archetypes at the end of history. I think, I think Platonism is a naive view of reality and that it's something we pass through in our intellectual process of maturation, and that you always want to maintain the idea of the archetype, but it has to be severely modified to meet some of the problems that have been discovered in the last couple of thousand years of doing that kind of philosophy. Sure, go ahead. If it's
things that based on altered states that I've been in, where returning to a more ordinary state, I have the sense clearly that everything is all this material, all the events, and everything is a fallout from some drama that I'm a part of. All my ideas, including, whatever I might construct about time and the whole thing. And so then I'm left with that sort of quandary about no matter what I construct and what experiments might do if I were a physicist. It's all to just confirm this other drama that's happening. That happens an infinite number of times and with infinite variations, etc.
Sort of the point that I would like to make is that is the point you're making, that reality is, if explored at all, if stressed, if pushed, it breaks apart. The concept isn't viable. The first thing to realize is, where is it writ large that anthropoid apes should be able to reach the bedrock of reality? Why should we imagine that beings like ourselves are somehow divinely charged with the opportunity to perceive the truth of the matter? This is what modern philosophy has come to understand. This is why Wittgenstein could come up with the notion of what he called true enough. That's a much more reasonable approach to things. I mean, after all, we're monkeys. And so what we need is models that are true enough and leave God alone in his or her heaven and just work with the things that are rationally apprehendable to us. You mention altered states. And I think if it weren't for altered states, our epistemic naivete would be much greater, because we could all just fall into the culturally sanctioned hallucination that this is in fact reality. But we all know from experiencing altered states that this is just some kind of agreed upon, socially sanctioned construct, that when you lean against it with drugs or philosophy or insight, it breaks up under the pressure of that. What we really are, what we call reality, is in fact nothing more than a culturally sanctioned and linguistically reinforced hallucination of some sort. And we can go outside of that hallucination, either by using drugs or physical practices like yoga, or simply by going outside of our reality. I mean, when you go to an Amazon tribe, all these things that you think are so important, you know, how the giants are doing, or what's happening on Wall Street, or how the Democrats are getting their act together. Nobody knows what in the world you're talking about. It is literally not real. And what's real is, you know, how the fish are spawning in the river and honey production that year. They have their own culturally sanctioned hallucination. Well, then when you take psychedelic drugs, you seem to dissolve the sort of the software of neurological processing, and language is that software that has been created to handle certain kinds of cultural modalities. Well, then you like penetrate beyond the screen, if you want to use a computer metaphor, and instead you discover there's assembly language in the machine, and it's deep in the machine and is rarely encountered except by hackers. I mean, that's what you're doing when you're taking psychedelic drugs, is you're opening the cabinet. You're going into the machinery, all those areas where it says the warranty will be voided if you remove this plate. Those are the plates that you're unscrewing and poking inside of, voiding the warranty on your model of reality. And we don't know to what degree this can go on. I recently was approached by the publishers Underwood Miller, and they asked me, some of you may know the science fiction writer Philip K. Dick. He came in the last 5 years of his life to believe that he was in a sense trapped inside one of his own novels, and he was the master of the parallel universe novel. He worked this theme so many ways. I mean, he was brilliant at it. And he underwent a series of experiences that we can't really judge. I mean, it's too facile to call it a psychotic break. And he spent the last 10 years of his life trying to understand what was happening to himself. And he reached the conclusion that the year AD 70 was followed immediately by the year 1948, and that the intervening couple of thousand years were like a textual interpolation by a demiurge, and that none of that ever happened, that we're actually living in the last years of the Roman Empire, that we are living in patristic time. And he saw superimposed over ordinary reality another reality which he was fully engaged in, living in. He was a person in this place and this time. Well, is that a serious delusion or a breaking through?
So
something that occurs to me as you're talking that might be interesting to pursue a little bit is at Esalen we're just starting an arts program, and in fact tomorrow we're having an auction for a dance platform, and I've heard you say that you think that the arts creativity is sort of the answer, and so that might be a topic for comment, at least, of something about what you have to say about the arts and how the arts are going to be an answer.
You mean how can doing art save the world? Yeah.
Or a smaller version of that.
Oh no, we always go to the top of the... If it doesn't save the world, why bother even discussing it? It's sort of the... Yeah, well, it's an interesting question. I mean, in a nutshell, and I'll go back to it, but the reason I think it's so important is because when we grapple with the problems that are, you know, many and complex around us, the tendency is to go for rational solution. But you might bear in mind that the consequences of rational solutions are what we are dealing with at the present. Rationalism has been the dominant paradigm for problem solving for about 500 years, and it has led us deeper and deeper into contradiction, resource mismanagement, dehumanization, misperception of each other, so forth and so on. That's why, in a way, I think that the art reflex is more important, because or more efficacious, because if we act from the point of view of wanting to create art, what we're really saying is that reality has outrun apprehension. We can no longer make rational sense out of reality. So the ego is set aside, and the logos or the muse is invoked, and then we produce art, and almost the distinguishing characteristic of great art is that it not be fully comprehensible to its creator. So we then act as agents of the logos when we create art, and the art that is created is then put out into the cultural environment of meaning, and is then subject to a kind of natural selection, similar to the kind of natural selection that goes on in an environment where biological species are competing. The shorthand way of saying this is the best idea will win, but it won't win unless it competes. You know, you can't win the race unless you run the race. So rather than beating our brains against the end of history, trying to create rational solutions to what is essentially an irrational situation in the first place, it would be, I think, much better to become servants of the logos, servants of the Gaian mind, and then to let the chips fall where they may. Let the selective pressures of intellectual history sort out among the many options, and those that are important will come to the fore. Does that get it as a brief pass? Why it's important? Mm-hmm. It's important because it's anti-rational, because it's anti-ego, because it says we are vessels and agents of the solution, but we can't, it doesn't spring from our ability to integrate data and reflect it back. It's much more irrational than that. This sort of goes to what I thought I would talk about a little bit tonight. I used the phrase a few minutes ago, reality outruns apprehension. This is actually a phrase from Moby Dick, not the part of Moby Dick that I will probably end up reading to you tonight. But what I thought would be interesting to talk about, basically because of its intrinsic interest and its recent intensification, is sort of the question, what is reality, number one, and then what's so great about it? And
why bother?
Yeah, why bother? I mean, we really have a bee in our bonnet about reality. When you get out of touch with it, this is considered not a good thing. Reality is the unmoving reference point in a universe of flux to which we are always supposed to go back and re-reference ourselves. And it's a funny concept. First of all, it is a concept. It's not an object with its own interior ontos. In other words, it doesn't have being outside of the culture's assumptions about it. This is the first big news about reality. The reality of the Witoto is a completely different reality from the West European or the Canadian. And yet the reality is, we assume that there is a kind of bedrock, and we call that reality, then everything is referenced back toward that. Well, I wanted to talk about it tonight because it's an incredibly slippery concept. I mean, I would say getting your hands on reality is about as likely as getting your hands on true love. You know, you're always going toward it or looking back at it, but you rarely have it in front of you in the moment. And yet the moment is where we spend most of our time. So we're kind of run ragged by the nostalgia for something we never knew, is what it almost comes down to. So, first of all, whenever we want to talk about something seriously and profoundly, we have recourse to science. However, reality is a term that, if it's used at all, it's used in philosophy, in ontology and epistemology. It is not a concept that you hear very often on the lips of scientists. Well, why is this? Well, it's because science, which is the enterprise which seeks to carry out a complete investigation of reality, has quickly satisfied itself that the beast can't be caged. It's very hard to actually come up with something concrete. And that's an interesting notion that any discussion of reality will tend to come back to. It wasn't until the 1930s that Alfred North Whitehead, in his book Process and Reality, created the great phrase that has now entered the language, the fallacy of misplaced concreteness. You've all probably heard this phrase, or maybe you haven't heard this phrase. But anyway, the fallacy of misplaced concreteness is the belief that there is something somewhere which is real, which can be depended upon, which everything else can be referenced back to. And as long as you are victim of this fallacy, you are philosophically naive and probably not at ease psychologically. Because, you know, it's like, as I said, nostalgia for something you never knew. The way science's method, which worked very well for the first 450 years, and by science, I don't mean science going back to the Greeks. I mean science since the Renaissance. Mathematically based Cartesian materialism is basically my notion of science. Its method is what's called reductionism. This is the theory that if you want to understand something, an atom, a plant, a society, a geological formation, what you do is you take it apart. You deconstruct it. You dismantle it and catalog its parts and then define their relationships to each other. And then somehow when you recombine all these maps of this deconstructed object, you then somehow possess it. And this worked very well up until well into the 20th century, because it was assumed that matter, which was taken to be somehow a primary constituent of reality, that matter was made out of tiny billiard balls that were called Hamiltonian atoms, and that these distinct and concrete billiard balls could be located absolutely in time and space, and their relationships to each other defined as charge, force, momentum, spin, so forth and so on, and that out of these primary qualities adhering to these elementary particles, notice these words primary, elementary, that are telling us we're getting close to bedrock, out of this you could reconstruct the world. The problem is, and I won't bore you with this because so many people have, quantum physics showed that these hard little billiard balls were the most tragic example of the fallacy of misplaced concreteness. They don't exist. There isn't such a thing. When you go down and down and down, suddenly everything becomes paradoxical. Ordinary logic no longer applies. And you know, without beating a dead horse, I would remind you that quantum physics, quantum electrodynamics, which is always held up as the greatest intellectual edifice ever constructed by the mind of man, is a complete mess in terms of the aesthetic of its logics, because it requires two logics operating simultaneously. You have what is called ordinary logic, the logic that we as animals intuitively gravitate toward, logic which says things such as, if it is A, then it is not B, if it is now, then it is not then, if it is after, then it is not before. This is kind of logic that assumes concrete objects in a linear time stream. But quantum physics then, to solve the problems it sets itself, it requires another kind of logic, an extremely exotic logic called Boolean algebra. And so what you get when you look at a quantum mechanical explanation of nature is you get what are called isles of Boole embedded in ordinary mathematical logic. So there are actually transition zones, very distinct transition zones, where you simply switch logics in midstream, literally in midstream, in order to solve the problem. Well, this then gives you a nice set of numbers in an experimental situation where you're trying to calculate the charge of the electron or the displacement value of particles or something like that, but it rests on this completely inelegant switching back and forth from one logic to another as the case requires, which means the human observer is brought in and you get to decide which logic to use, and then you can use one for a few minutes and then switch back to the other and go back and forth. And upon such shifting sand as this, the entire edifice of science rests. Okay, well, that's really all I want to say about the scientific view of reality. It's just to... Yeah, Paul.
I just wanted to say that... I'm not sure. No, I don't see science that way, and I think maybe one has to distinguish between science and physics, because in the 19th century there were many physicists who realized and argued against the possibility of a mechanistic universe, and quantum mechanics was the final death toll of that point of view, but it was argued for 100 years and maybe 300 years before that that mechanism can't exist, the reality doesn't exist.
You mean, are you thinking of vitalism?
No, I'm just thinking that it was clear to many physicists, at least in the last century, that we weren't going to be able. In other words, this notion of atoms was very clearly understood to be just a model. People, physicists at least, and some physicists, didn't confuse the notion of a model or a concept with reality. And in fact, argued quite clearly that these concepts aren't reality. In fact, we will never find a mechanism for our observations.
Yeah, well, the great enlightenment of 19th century physics occurred around the issue of fields, because until James Clerk Maxwell and Lorentz and these people wrote the equations for the electromagnetic field, it was denied that such a thing was possible, because it had this quality, this apparent quality of action at a distance. And that completely freaked out 19th century expectations of how nature should behave. We take this completely for granted. I mean, there's a radio sitting in this cabinet that we could flip on, and if we weren't in such a benighted geographical situation, we could hear hundreds of AM and FM radio stations. Well, those are wave mechanical systems that are filling this room, that are invisible to ordinary perception. To the 19th century mind, this was completely occult and astonishing. We take it for granted. Marshall McLuhan at one point suggested that the worldwide electrification of the planet through the spread of radio and television and electrical systems was actually the descent of the Holy Ghost into history, that electricity was the Holy Ghost to control and to understand, because we can do it. We don't need the second coming of Christ. We don't need divine intervention to destroy this planet. We can do it well enough on our own, thank you. So a huge responsibility evolves upon people within the global culture to try and come to terms with what is possible and what is to be done. And I think we have to doubt everything that we're told. All the ideology that we have inherited served a different kind of world. I mean, don't forget that as recently as 100 years ago, people believed that the Earth was created on September 15th, 4004 BC. I mean, the steam engine was the most powerful form of technology that existed. In the last 100 years, we have gone more than half of the distance that we've traveled in the last 50,000 years. And you can actually begin to see the outlines of what it's all about. As caretakers of the Earth, as caretakers of intelligence, because this is all the intelligence that we know of, we must, in fact, come to terms with what is being asked of us. What is it that we are supposed to be doing? How can we rationally order our societies to maximize the values that we inherently and intrinsically feel to be worth saving? You mean
the cause
why?
Is to create culture.
Why did we fall into history?
Why did we create culture?
What were we afraid of?
What were we afraid of?
What were we afraid of? I've been reading Camille Paglia, and she says it's the...
You rascal.
Oh. Well, you know what she says.
Oh, I know what she says, yes.
So the chaos, the underworld, that quality, the violence of nature, the disorder.
Well, I think what happened, and you know, you've all heard me talk about it in operational terms, that we were as embedded in nature as the fox and the leafcutter ant and the polar bear until 100,000 years ago or something like that. And then this ability to signify, it has something to do with our relationship to shamanism and psychedelic drugs. You see, when you look at primates of all types, going clear back to squirrel monkeys, you always get male dominance. Male dominance was not invented in the Middle East 3,000 years ago. Squirrel monkeys have alpha male primates, and anthropoid apes, all of the primates have this problem. But I really believe that we temporarily overcame it. About from, let's say, 25,000 years ago to 10,000 years ago, we temporarily overcame the tendency for male dominance to occur as a natural part of our being social animals. And this happened because shamanism evolved as an institution which relied on psychoactive plants to dissolve the male ego. And it's not only, I mean, we don't have to call it the male ego, that just polarizes and genderizes the thing. It's the ego. The ego is this strange transference of loyalty from the group to the self, the individual body. And then we call that the self. The reason this, so that psychedelic shamanism, specifically the use of psilocybin on the plains of Africa, was like a chemical inoculation against the formation of ego. And under the influence of psychedelic compounds, we evolved language and social roles and rudimentary agriculture and nomadism, all of these things. But then the psychedelic substances which made this possible began to become less and less available. This is simply because of climatic change in Africa. You see, the Sahara, what is now the Sahara Desert, was a veldt of grassland throughout prehistory. As late as Roman times, the Roman historian Pliny referred to North Africa as the breadbasket of Rome. It means that climatologically it was entirely different. And in that African theater, we emerged out of animal organization and into a world of language, cognition, ritual, ceremony, so forth and so on. And it was a style of psychedelic shamanism complexed with an orgiastic religious style. Now, the reason this is important, this orgiastic style, is because it makes it impossible to trace lines, lines of male paternity. Women know who their children are because they see their children come out of their bodies. But men couldn't know that. And so all values were group values. The tribe was as identified with true being as we now identify our ego. So people were altruistic. Not in any holier than thou or pietistic way. It's just simply how they were, in the same way that the members of an anthill are altruistic. I mean, ants don't flee from a problem because they're trying to save their own necks. They hurl themselves at the problem until it is solved, because conservation of the group values is the most important thing. Well, when...
But wait, so why could... What, instead of being a male society, why then couldn't this be passed on by the female? I mean, the female knows who her offspring is. Why?
But the female has built into her physiology a boundary dissolving experience in the form of the birth experience. And in these African tribal societies, you know, it didn't happen once or twice in a woman's life. It happened a dozen or 20 times. So women, by virtue of giving birth, And by virtue of this experience of seeing another person come out of their body, can never get so firmly embedded this notion of their inviolate and unique self. So it's just biologically scripted into femaleness that several times in your life you're going to be melted down into this situation. And it's a very deep imprinting. In the absence of psychedelic plants or drugs, a male can go from birth to the grave and never have this experience. You know, and millions of people do that. Millions of people go from the birth to the grave without ever discovering the relativistic nature of the ego. They entirely identify it with the self, when in fact it isn't that at all. Now, the mystery in all of this is the fact that it's kind of reductionist to say that taking these psychedelic plants dissolves the ego, because there has to be something then which rushes into this now empty space where the ego previously held sway. What rushes in to that liberated space is what I call the Gaian mind, that there is actually a hyper-intelligent being on this planet, or in this planet. It perhaps is this planet, but it is sentient. It thinks. It can communicate. We are like atoms inside the body, or cells inside the body of this enormous organism, which is the cause of our religious obsessing. The reason we're always running around looking for God Almighty is because we evolved on a planet inhabited by a super intelligence that we have lost contact with. And so we deny its intelligence. We, at this point, even deny its vitality. I mean, you know, the Judeo-Christian shtick is that nature is to be at the service of man. And, you know, this is a complete inversion of the idea that human beings should be the active hands of the Gaian mind. This didn't happen for any, there's no bad guy in this scenario. It's simply that the climatological conditions which allowed this social mode that was characterized by nomadic pastoralism, orgy, and psychedelic shamanism was gradually replaced by, because of drying of the African continent, the psychedelic substances were no longer available. And there was even an intermediate phase where the psychedelic substance, if it was the mushroom, was preserved in honey, so that the great festivals became further and further apart in time, and the ego enters then like a tumor. It begins to form in the personalities of human beings. If you're engaging in psychedelic intoxication and orgy at every full moon, there is no chance for the ego to get a hold. I mean, it's just an aberration that everybody jumps on and is gotten rid of. But if these ceremonies become yearly or less frequent, then these funny notions get going in the more powerful males. Why shouldn't I control more females? Why shouldn't I have more of the food supply? Why shouldn't this area, in fact, be for me to hunt in alone? You get all these concepts of mindness that arise out of the growth of this tumorous, cancerous, maladaptive self-defining, because that it doesn't serve. And we have committed ourselves to this thing so whole hog for the past 5,000, 10,000 years that now we're so deep into it that it's not clear we can ever extricate it ourselves from it, except, and this is the raison d'etre for my career, is we have to go back to the archaic solution, which is, and it can't be orgy. That can't be the archaic solution that we implement, because we're not a nomadic tribe of pastoralists, only 70 or 80 human beings. We're a global culture of 5 billion people. If we tried to resuscitate lunar orgies, we'd have a wave of social and sexually transmitted diseases that would probably finish us once and for all. So the orgy thing is not the answer. But the psychedelic option still exists, it still dissolves the ego, and it still puts you in contact with viable group values. So this is what this is perhaps an answer. And I don't advocate it because I think it's a sure thing. I advocate it because I think it's the only game in town. Hell, if hortatory beating on people could have worked, then we would have solved all our problems thousands of years ago, because Buddha and Christ and all these other people, they had the right idea. It's just that ideas don't cut the mustard. It has to be an experience, a real experience. And a boundary-dissolving experience is so corrosive to all the institutions of dominator society that no religion in the West since has been able to come to terms with the psychedelic experience, because it mitigates male dominance, hierarchy, and all the other things that are the methods by which we do business.
Why do you think that nature would have it that there would be this window of opportunity to develop an ego to begin with? What?
Well, it was that we had a chemically mediated symbiosis with the Gaian mind, and it was it wasn't a locked symbiosis like you get in lichens or something like that. It was a kind of flirtation with symbiosis. It was that we took these psychedelic plants and contacted this hyperdimensional mind of nature and discovered that because it was hyperdimensional, because it wasn't constrained in space and time the way we are, that it had useful information. Information, very practical information. Where has the game gone? This is what shamans are good for, is to tell you where the game has gone. How will the weather be next year? Classical problem for shamans. Well, how do they know this stuff? How can so you see it? Shamanism is essentially a going into a higher dimension to obtain information that then feeds back into the group destiny. Well, how can these shamans know this stuff? How can they attain to this superhuman level of understanding? It's that they get in touch with a different kind of intelligence. An intelligence to whom where the game will be next year is as transparent as where the game was last year. Because past and future don't exist for that intelligence. And our relationship to that intelligence was one of devotee to goddess or supplicant to mystery. But eventually the connection was broken, and meanwhile the ego was arising, and the ego is like a mirroring of this larger psychic function. In other words, the ego is our pathetic attempt to create God on our own. This was Julian Jaynes' theory. He thought, you see, that up until as late as Homeric times, which is 800 BC, that if you got into a tight spot and were about to be offed or something, miraculously a voice would appear, would come on, it would just turn on in your head, and it would say, "You should get out of there." And people thought this was a god. It was a god. But eventually, they were able to assimilate this psychic function into the personality. And then they said, well, that's not God talking. That's me. That's myself. And this is the idea where God is then located inside my body. And I take orders from this inner God that I call the ego. And if it is allowed to develop, and it's strange, it always develops along these patriarchal lines, you know. It brooks no babbling. It's not interested in argument. It knows what is to be done. And then the only time you get a problem is when you place one ego in contact with another. And then, of course, they go at it, hammer and tongs. But originally what we had was a symbiotic relationship with this Gaian mind. And this is the mystery that haunts this planet, haunts our history, haunts our psychedelic experiences and our dreams. It's that there really is a controlling super intelligence that can be contacted through psychedelic drugs, presumably religious practice, when you see how long they've been making the claim, although it must be a high noise signal when you do it that way, because they seem to get it always skewed off in some weird direction that then reinforces paternalistic institutions. But this is what all this goddess talk is about, is either we are becoming more sensitive to the presence of the Gaian mind, or the Gaian mind, under pressure of the approaching apocalyptic crisis, is beginning to raise its voice louder and louder and louder. So that now, you know, when you go into nature loaded, every rock, every tree, every stream is saying, awaken, awaken, come to focus. There's minutes to go, as William Burroughs likes to say, you know. So we have to connect up. And so we are, in a sense, the hands of this diffuse supermind that is spread through nature. And our presence as thinking, reflecting, culture-building individuals is not simply an amazing but meaningless set of circumstances. Our presence as a global technical civilization signifies the onset of the final crisis. It's as though, you know, you watch a pond and the surface is smooth, mirror smooth. Well, then the surface of the pond begins to churn. This is the signal that something huge is about to emerge out of the pond. And human history is that turbulence on the still surface of nature. Nature would never have allowed a phenomenon like human history to get going were it not in response to a deeply felt planetary crisis that is approaching at ever-accelerating speed. And I have enough faith in nature to believe that when the moment finally is upon us, we'll be ready. But the tools are being laid up right now. The ultimate tools, not the prototype tools. The bow and arrow, that was a prototype. The catapult, that was a prototype. The B-17, that was a prototype. But thermonuclear-tipped intercontinental ballistic missiles, this is not the prototype. This is the actual instrument by which you could save a planet as well as destroy it, because you're at last dealing on the level of energies necessary to make those kinds of changes. And I think the evidence is all around us that the historical mode cannot persist. It can't. Just draw all the curves. Output of petroleum distillates, output of energy, population growth, proliferation of weapons. When you draw all of these curves, they can't be propagated 500 years into the future. Sometime in the next 50 years, we're going to have to make or break what history was all about. And the arising of global culture, the arising of an integrated electronic awareness, high-speed computational machinery, tremendously powerful weapons, spacecraft, all of this stuff looks to me like the raw material for a salvational exercise. And notice that it's not only a way to save the planet, it's in a sense a way to save not only ourselves, but to save our ancestors as well. This, if we can act in a moment of great crisis to preserve the planet from ruination, we will redeem human history. Then it all makes sense. The pogroms, the migrations, the brutality, the stupidity. It was all toward a purpose. And then somehow those lives that were lost in those pogroms and invasions and migrations and so forth are given meaning. A meaning which they will totally not have if we simply blow the planet apart and wreck nature and ruin the oceans and blow off the atmosphere. Then it just looks like a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury that signifies nothing. So it's as though the meaning itself is in our hands. What shall we make of this? Is it just, as James Joyce said, atoms and ifs? Or is there a plan, a process, a plot, and a role for us that will give us some dignity in this situation, which otherwise, up to this point, as far as I can see, we totally lack? I mean, it's all very well to spend an afternoon wandering around the Louvre, but on the other hand, you know, spend the next day wandering around the slums of Calcutta, and you just really have to wonder about what the human enterprise is about. Now I will read you this little quote from Moby Dick, which sort of gets to some of this. Are you all familiar with Moby Dick? Are any of you familiar with Moby Dick? You should be. I mean, this is the greatest work of prose ever written by an American without contest, I think. I mean, I like to think that when human history is written, Americans will be remembered for two things. They went to the moon, and they're the people who produced Moby Dick. I mean, this is our Odyssey. This is our Odyssey and our Iliad. Nobody's ever gone past it. Okay, there's a scene early on. You all know that it's a whale hunt, right? Okay, so there is a scene where the captain, who is running this show and driving this thing, this hunt for this whale, to a truly apocalyptic conclusion, because for him this is no hunt for an animal, this is a confrontation with an alien god, and he is determined to murder this thing because it, as he delicately puts it, dismasted him, meaning it bit off his leg and destroyed his sexual machinery. And his first mate, who functions as Christian right reason, wimpy little Starbuck, says, "Vengeance on a dumb brute," cried Starbuck, "that simply smote thee from blindest instinct? Madness! To be enraged with a dumb thing, Captain Ahab, seems blasphemy." And Ahab says, "Hark ye yet again, the little lower layer. All visible objects, man, are but as pasteboard masks. But in each event, in the living act, the undoubted deed, there some unknown but still reasoning thing puts forth the moldings of its features from behind the unreasoning mask. If man will strike, strike through the mask. How can the prisoner reach outside except by thrusting through the wall? To me, the white whale is that wall. Shove near to me. Sometimes I think there is naught beyond. But 'tis enough. He tasks me. He heaps me. I see in him outrageous strength with an inscrutable malice sinewing it. That inscrutable thing is chiefly what I hate. And be the white whale agent or be the white whale principal, I will wreak that hate upon him. Talk not to me of blasphemy. I would strike out the sun if it insulted me. For could it do that, then could I do the other, since there is ever a sort of fair play. And that was the point I wanted to make about 2 points, striking through the mask to achieve reality, and that we can do it. Because there is ever a sort of fair play. The field is level. The cards are not stacked against us. If we play our hand right, we can take the whole game. They wouldn't have it any other way. That's right. By the way, I'm getting into that book by Camille Paglia called Sexual Persona. And it's definitely the read of the season. And I didn't realize the publication date is listed as September 1991. So it's hot. And I read the section on Moby Dick, which comes very close to the end. And if all of it's as good as that, then it's really something. I mean, there hasn't been that much fun between the covers of one book since Marshall McLuhan wrote The Gutenberg Galaxy. So, you know, if you think of yourself as a feminist, an art historian, a literary critic, an egghead, all these things, she's just outrageous. I think we have to get her here as fast as possible. Because she's really freewheeling and makes a lot of people mad, which is always a good sign, I think. It's called Sexual Persona by Camille Paglia. Maybe some of you saw about a month ago in the Image magazine, which is the insert in the Sunny, there was an article about her and they put her on the cover. And she's very controversial and says lots of provocative things. And the article stressed her dumping on Derrida and Lacan and Foucault and that whole crowd and saying, you know, all of them put together were not worth one page of William Burroughs, basically. And, you know, not that we care about this, but in academia, this is big news because they're in awe of all those people. I tried to read Derrida. I couldn't make head nor tails of it. It just seemed to me like anti-thought. All of this is inspired by a number of papers that have recently been called to my attention, if I can get this the way I want it. And one of them is called, and I recommend it to your attention, it appeared in the June 1989 issue of Zygon, and it's called The Omega Point as Eschaton, Answers to Pannenberg's Questions for Scientists. And this is, it's by Frank Tipler, and this is a very interesting article which tries to argue for the reality of Christian eschatological hermeneutics in the light of information theory, and actually makes a number of points that I thought I would be alone in making for my entire life, and now I see that I'm actually an infant in this department, and that these people have thought more deeply and more widely and with a more stunning commitment to radical ideas than I could have even conceived of. I mean, it's humbling stuff. I mean, they're talking here about computer strategies to resurrect the dead, not some of the dead, all of the dead. And a number of ideas that I confess were completely alien and exciting to me. And I also have a correspondence between Frank Tipler and Hans Moravec, the author of this little thing I just read you, and a paper by Moravec that apparently has not yet been published called Time Travel and Computing. And time travel is sort of what I wanted to talk about this evening from a certain peculiar perspective. One of the ideas that I've had to embed in my system fairly uncomfortably, because I think of myself basically as a skeptic and a rationalist, is the idea that the world is on the brink of a tremendous transformation, a transformation on a scale such that it can really only be compared to the events which created the universe in the first place. This is what ties this series of notions to Christian eschatology, because the unique preoccupation of Western religion, whether it be Judaism, Islam, or Christianity, is this weird insistence on the end of the world, the collapse of reality as we know it. You don't get this in Eastern thinking. As you all probably know, Hinduism is a theory of what is essentially a steady state. There are cycles of outpouring of phenomena and then regressive cycles when everything recondenses. But the universe is basically thought to be eternal. And this then poses no problem for rational expectation, because it's very easy to imagine an eternal universe. In Christianity, to preserve the rationality of expectation, the eschatological event, I guess I should explain that term, all these ESCH words, eschaton, eschatological, so forth and so on, mean we're referencing the final things. The branch of theology that is called eschatology is the study of the final things, the end of the world. And the way Christianity has handled it to preserve rationality, at least superficially, is by setting it far, far in the future. Then it doesn't irritate or demand a great deal of thought and consideration. My notion has, against my own intellectual gravity, has pushed me toward the conclusion that it is near, which puts me in the same category as all those people in cartoons carrying signs which say, you know, repent for the end is near. And I it's the thing, I mean, I feel, shy. I don't know if I have the decency to feel shy, but I feel always reluctant to talk about it because it is the most counterintuitive position in the system that I've tried to elaborate. Because not only do I think it's near, but I think that we can say when it is. And just so you aren't kept hanging in suspense.
Tomorrow at 8:30.
Close, close. December 22nd, 2012, at dawn, Eastern Standard Time, the universe will roll up like a one of those blinds, you know? It will just roll up. The stars will fall from heaven. Reality as we know it will completely disappear to be replaced by something else. Now, why would anyone think such a thing? I mean, what set of rational premises could lead to such an irrational notion? Well, I have this idea that there is a counter-entropic principle built into the universe that has not been described by science at all. It may have been noticed, but never in its inclusive nature. And I call this anti-entropic principle novelty. Novelty it has been increasing since the very first moments of the birth of the universe. Whether you subscribe to the orthodox cosmology of a Big Bang, which I would like to sit on the fence about, it seems to me, I mean, you may think my notion is unlikely, but you should remind yourself that what science believes is that the universe sprang from nothing in a single instant from an area whose diameter was less than that of the electron. It seems to me this is almost like the limiting case for the incredible. I mean, if you could believe that, what would you resist believing? I mean, if you believe that, you may be interested in a large bridge over the Hudson River that my family has had for generations and that we're willing to sell you for a dollar. But this is what science believes. This is what most scientists believe, although in all fairness, in the last 5 years, this has gotten more shaky. Not everybody now believes in the Big Bang. Well, what I would like to substitute for the Big Bang is what I call the big surprise. And the big surprise doesn't come at the beginning of the universe. It comes at the end of the universe. Which seems to me, you know, if you want to, the battle of the singularities. Orthodox science says the entire universe sprang from a tiny area in a single instant. The notion that it sprang from pure nothingness. It sprang from a point-like dimension that was, so far as we can tell, utterly without any quality whatsoever. This seems to me the least likely environment in which to seek a singularity. I mean, how can we imagine, unless we call upon God Almighty, a perturbation in a flawless nothingness that would usher into, you know, 10 high 47 particles of many types streaming outward, symmetry breaks, so forth and so on. It seems to me that all cosmological myths require a singularity of some sort, but some singularities are more likely than others. And so in my notion, and I call it my notion because so many people have told me I'm completely welcome to it. In my notion, the place to look for a singularity is in the most complicated circumstances imaginable. Not an unflawed emptiness, but a world where you have atomic chemistry, polymer chemistry, organic chemistry, advanced animals and plants, languages, cultures, technologies, information coding and regurgitation systems. In other words, the more complexity that you can pile into a situation, the more likely you're going to get what is called an emergent property, or a singularity, or the big surprise. And so, as I look back at the history of the universe, over any scale you care to name, the last 5 years, the last 500 years, the last 500 million years, the last 5 billion years, there is a generality which seems to hold, which is complexity, once come into existence, is retained and folded back into the interstices of being to produce yet more complexity. this is linked, and at least appears linked, to the cooling of the universe. At the Big Bang, the temperature of the universe was trillions of degrees, and there was no, there wasn't even atomic chemistry. There was just a plasma of electrons. And then after some time, measured in nanoseconds, the temperature of the universe fell sufficiently so that stable orbits could be established around atomic nuclei. And then you have the emergence of simple inorganic chemistry. Well, then after a further fall in temperature and much longer period of time, you get the thermal disruption of chemical bonds falls below the limit where you can get complex molecular structures. And then a whole new set of emergent properties building on the levels which preceded until finally you get the birth of stars. And that is basically huge lumps of condensed hydrogen, the simplest of all elements. The hydrogen aggregates into stars in such amounts that tremendous pressures are set up at the center of these hydrogen masses, sufficient pressures for fusion to begin to take place. And fusion cooks out iron and other heavy elements, including carbon. And carbon then becomes the key to the next level of emergent complexity. And from there to us, it's only a series of these declensions. But what's interesting about these declensions into complexity is that each phase happens more quickly than the phase that preceded it. So that we actually are not peripheral to this process. We're at the center of this mandala by several different ways of thinking about it. The most convincing, I suppose, is that the density of connections in the human cerebral cortex makes the human cerebral cortex, without contest, the most densely ramified material in the universe. We carry within ourselves, then, the most complex organization that has been laid on to the material universe. And it seems to me this is a strong argument that we are at the cutting edge of this process of emergent novelty. Now, up until a million years or so ago, we were just one more animal wandering around on this planet, albeit a sort of weird animal, bipedalism, binocular vision, complex pack signaling. But on the other hand, wolves and dogs and ants have complex pack signaling. But then we began to elaborate. Notice that up to that point, the most sophisticated information storage system that novelty had evolved was genetic storage. Storage in long polymerized molecules that templated other molecules to reproduce themselves. Well, with the emergence of human language, you get what is called epigenetic storage and conveyance of information in poetry, dance, ritual of all sorts, artistic endeavors of all sorts. This is the unique domain of human beings, and it represents a vast acceleration in the rate at which this kind of informational business can be transduced. Well, then, so it flows forward, and then about 12,000 years ago, we really get going by building cities, beginning to notch wood with our observations of lunar cycles and stuff like that, and then you know the rest of the story. I mean, it's just a jump from, as I said the other night, chipping flint off a core to hurling an instrument outside the solar system so that it can look back at our planetary system. An elf told me that, now there's a fine thing for a scientist to say. An elf told me that time travel is possible, but it is constrained in ways which are not normally part of our expectation of time travel. The way in which it's constrained is once time travel is discovered, you can travel as far into the future as you wish, but you can't travel into the past any further than the moment of the invention of the first time machine. The reason for this is that before the invention of the first time machine, there were no time machines, and how can you take a time machine into a domain where there aren't any? You see, it's just to preserve logical consistency.
That's like saying you can't drive a car where there hasn't been a car driven before.
That's right. You can't take a car where there are no roads. When cars were first invented, the main objection to them was, what are you going to do with this thing? You know, there's nowhere to, you know, it can't go where a horse can go, so what good is it? So here's a fantasy scenario, which for a while I liked very much. It's that quantum physics and nanotechnology and all this malarkey is refined and focused toward the notion of building a time machine so that then on the morning of December 22nd, 2012, at the World Time Institute in the Amazon, the first time journey is about to be taken. And the whole world is watching on holographic television as the Lady Temponaut is strapped into the machinery that will hurl her centuries into the future. And there's a countdown, and a button is pushed, and off she goes. Now, most people's interest would be to follow this woman wherever she's going, but let's forget her for a moment. The point has been made. She disappears. We assume she went off into the future. But what happens right there, right then? It seems to me in the very next millisecond, thousands of time machines would begin arriving from the future simply because they had driven to the end of the road. They had come back in time to witness the first journey into the future. It's as though you could take your Piper Cub and fly it to Kitty Hawk, North Carolina in 1906 to see the Wright flyer take off. You see? Are you all with me so far?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, right. Now, there's a problem with this, which some of you I'm sure are thinking, I hope anyway, which is what's called the grandfather paradox, which is the old conundrum that haunts all time travel schemes, which is, if time travel were possible, you could go back in time and kill your own grandfather. Well, then you wouldn't exist. Well, so then this sets up a logical impossibility. Either you exist or you don't exist. And some science fiction authors have assumed that somehow massive influxes of synchronicity would preserve your grandfather. You know, you would approach him with your Saturday night special, but it would blow up in your hand, or it would ricochet off the St. Christopher medal he always wore, or something like that, because he cannot be killed by you, because in that case you wouldn't exist, in which case he couldn't be killed by you. And this troubled me for a long time then. What exactly would happen in this situation if a time... Because the according to Hans Moravec of the Robotics Institute of Carnegie Mellon University, I mean, time travel is no big deal. The first paragraph of this paper, "The last few years have been good for time machines. Kip Thorne's renowned general relativity group at Caltech invented a new quantum gravitational approach to building a time gate, and an international collaboration gave a convincing rebuttal of the grandfather paradox arguments. Another respected group suggested time machines that exploit quantum mechanical time uncertainty. The technical requirements for these suggestions exceed our present capabilities, but each new approach seems less onerous than the last. There is hope yet that time travel will eventually become possible, even cheap." So I then saw another possibility, and this is the way we can fulfill the expectation of Christian hermeneutics, and but not require the second coming of Christ or the intercession of God Almighty into history or all these other extreme unlikelihoods. And to understand it, we have to have recourse to a physical model in a very simple realm of chemistry and physics, which is the Bernoulli gas laws. Some of you, I'm sure, are familiar with these, and they're very intuitive and easy to understand. We have a cylinder, and it's a it contains a vacuum, and at one end of the cylinder we have a valve, and the valve is connected to a line which is connected to a tank of some inert gas, say nitrogen. So we open the valve to let the nitrogen rush into the cylinder that previously was a vacuum. Now, what happens inside that cylinder, I think, is intuitively obvious to all of us. The pressure equalizes over all points equally. In other words, you can't have 50 pounds of pressure at one end of the cylinder and 5 pounds of pressure at the other. We understand that in a gas, pressure distributes itself evenly in order to achieve equilibrium. Okay, hold that notion in your mind. Now think of our world in the late 1990s as a sphere or a cylinder of that sort, and think of cultures as gases at various pressures, and let's assign low pressures to the bare-assed folks in the Amazon and eastern Indonesia, and let's assign high pressures to the folks in Manhattan and at Caltech and Cambridge and Los Angeles and London. Well, then we can predict correctly, in fact, what is happening sociologically on this planet. What is happening is that the high-tech cultures are totally overwhelming the traditional cultures. The values of Manhattan and Los Angeles are flooding everywhere, and in spite of the tiny lip service we give to shamanism and body painting, the truth of the matter is Amazon cultures are not really making a major contribution at this point to the evolution of high-tech, global, information-dense electronic culture. Okay, that's the second level of this Bernoulli metaphor. So now let's go back to the situation where we send the Lady Temple Knot off into the future. I'm not familiar with how they overcame the grandfather paradox, so we'll pretend that the grandfather paradox is very strong.
I want to say something about the grandfather paradox.
Okay, I'm close to question time. Let me press forward relentlessly here. Because the coffee's running out, I can feel it. The equilibrium density is dropping. Okay, so we send the Lady Temponaut off into the future, but now with what we know about the equalization of high cultures versus low in a temporal medium, what happens from our point of view is that the rest of the history of the universe happens instantly. That even if it's billions of years of human culture and downloading into machines and claiming star system after star system and so forth and so on, somehow that the state vector of all of those event systems collapses. I call this the God whistle principle. It's that we can actually call God into history. We can summon the end state of human evolution to appear a millisecond after we successfully achieve the implementation of this technology of time travel in order to avoid all the paradoxes that would prevail if there was any extension to the post-time travel era beyond the moment of its inception. So this is a way of, in a sense, forcing the evolution of the universe, and it creates the phase transition of the eschaton, and is, to my mind, a practical. It creates the basin of attraction within the domain of our own lives. Now, is there any kind of precedent for something like this, even metaphorically in our own experience? Well, it turns out, yes, there is, in a kind of bizarre anecdote which should sober us considerably as we think about these things. When the first atomic weapon was built by the Manhattan Project in the desert of New Mexico, Fermi and Oppenheimer and all these people got together the night before the test at Trinity. And Fermi had a pad like this on which he had scrawled some equations, and he had reached the conclusion in the week before that they were not sure how high the temperature would go when they triggered this device, and Fermi had some back of the envelope calculations which caused him to believe that the nitrogen in the atmosphere of the planet would begin to burn if they tested this thing, and that they would in effect ignite the atmosphere of the planet, and the fireball would spread around the entire planet and destroy everything. And they spent half the night going over these things, and they finally decided that the information necessary to make the decision was not available, and so they said, well, hell, throw the switch, you know. At least it'll get to show those Japs and Germans that we mean business. So, and then of course the test was carried out. The nitrogen did not burn, and instead we were ushered into the glorious era of weapons of mass destruction. So let me see, I've got some notes here. I think I covered everything. What's interesting about this is that for the first time in this article by Frank Tipler called The Omega Point as Eschaton, he seems, and this is why Paul is here, and I couldn't really get into it because it's crazy to repeat what you can't understand, but by an analysis and interpretation of quantum mechanics, Tipler reaches the conclusion that there is an omega point, and that it does represent the funneling together of all the what are called world lines. And he, for purposes of mental comfort, sets it far in the future. But in principle, there is no reason to do that. 12 or 13 years ago, the Swedish cosmologist Hans Alfven wrote a wonderful little book called Worlds and Anti-Worlds, in which he made the suggestion that the entire universe is what's called a vacuum fluctuation. Ex nihilo, literally out of nothingness. However, there's a caveat, which is this creation ex nihilo can only occur if what's called parity is conserved. Now, what this means is that these particles which come into being out of nothingness must come into existence paired with their antiparticle. And so it comes into being, let's say, an electron and an anti-electron, and they divide on separate trajectories, and then they reconnect and collide with each other, and parity is conserved. In other words, nothing really happened. No laws of physics were violated because they annihilated each other. Now, for a long time, a while, this was thought to be entirely a kind of a theoretical construct. But then it was noticed that the theoretical models of black holes, which we referred to a few days ago, seemed to imply that no radiation could leave a black hole. And yet certain kinds of black holes were observed to be giving off hard radiation in the form of X-rays. And it was realized that what was happening was vacuum fluctuations were taking place in the vicinity of the black hole, and because one particle went one way and one the other, the black hole interfered with the conservation of parity, and one of the particles was being sucked into the black hole, and the other particle was flying off into the ordinary universe and being seen by astronomers as hard radiation. So the fact that this process goes on has now been confirmed. Well, now an interesting thing about these vacuum fluctuations is that quantum physics places no upper limit on the size of a vacuum fluctuation. What it says is that the smaller the vacuum fluctuation, the fewer particles that are involved, the more likely the vacuum fluctuation is. And obviously, from observing black holes, we can see that very small vacuum fluctuations occur quite frequently. Well, Alfven took all this and said, well, then, is it not possible that the entire universe, our entire universe, is simply a very large vacuum fluctuation, a vacuum fluctuation involving something like 10 high 50 particles, and they have poured into the manifold in which we find ourselves, and an antimatter universe, invisible to us because it's in another dimension, was born at the same time. And so one universe went off into a higher dimensional manifold this way, and another one went off in the other direction. And what this sets us up for is the possibility allowed by this interpretation of quantum physics that the entire universe could disappear instantly. Not gradually. You wouldn't see the stars going out, but because this is all happening in a hyperspace of some sort, which treats this manifold as a point-like entity. So what you would have is just click, and all particles in the universe would disappear, and the original unflawed nothingness would be restored. Actually, no. there's a further caveat to all this, which is all particles have their antimatter, antiparticle twin, except the photon. The photon is this mysterious particle which is different from all other particles. It either has no antiparticle, or somehow it has its own antiparticle embedded within it. So what would happen in the case of a universe which was a vacuum fluctuation, which encountered its ghost image and conserved parity and canceled all particles except photons, is that you would suddenly have a universe made of nothing but light. Nothing but light. And we then have to model the physics of a universe where the only kinds of particles that exist are light. Well, it's interesting that all these human traditions of transcendentalism make a big deal about light. I mean, light is the metaphor for spirit. And the supposition is that the rarefaction of matter and of the flesh releases us into a realm of light. And I am not physicist enough by a long shot to say what the behavior of a universe made of light would be, but I do know enough to say that if you or I were made of light, our subjective experience of the universe would be ruled by relativistic physics, and we would have the impression that we could go anywhere instantly, and we would have the impression that the universe was aging around us at a tremendous rate. Because you see, the time dilation of the general theory of relativity says that as you approach the speed of light, time slows down. Now, it's assumed that you can't reach the speed of light, because as you approach the speed of light, your mass asymptotically increases, so that to push a single atom to the speed of light would require more energy than there is in the entire universe, because this particle would have become so massive that there isn't enough energy to propel it. But a photon never moves slower than the speed of light. It never moves faster than the speed of light either. So the photon, if you were made of photons and you went from here to Zenebel-Ganubi, let's say, a star in our galaxy with a wonderful name, your impression of the travel time would be zero. You wouldn't, and so again, here is a way, without invoking God Almighty, where physics seems to lay into our hands metaphors for the anticipation of the eschaton. Paul, do you want to say something at this point?
It's fascinating to hear you playing with physics. You know, everything has to be conserved. It's not just parity in the vacuum fluctuation. I mean, matter, antimatter. Chad's whole parity is just one of a dozen conservation ones that has to be conserved in those phenomena. And they're happening all the time from the point of view of physics. Inside our body, there's trillions of these virtual reactions occurring all the time. And they can be intercepted. I mean, you can have a gamma ray break into a particle and antiparticle, and you can intercept them before they come back together again, and that's how they're detected on photographic plates or cloud chambers. But everything you say is right. One thing, I don't think this notion of the Big Bang, I mean, I'm not sure whether I subscribe to the Big Bang model, but it's not so far-fetched, because if there was something in the universe, then we'd have a real problem explaining how it got here. So the simplest thing to assume is that there's nothing here.
You mean that we are in a vacuum fluctuation?
Well, no, just that there's nothing here. I mean, that there was nothing before the Big Bang and there's nothing after.
This sounds like Buddhism.
That's right, the vacuum fluctuation includes everything, good and evil, male, female. The whole thing added together as a zero, just like it always was.
Well, then what is the... What are the complex appearances that impinge upon our senses, and what are we then?
Because we choose to pay attention to only half of the situation, but if we could, if we will let ourselves be and experience the whole, then it all, it's all unified.
It cancels.
It all cancels to zero.
Well, this refers back to something you and I were talking about at dinner. We all assume that there is one past and one future. But it's not clear why we assume that. I mean, think about it for a moment. We're all here gathered in this room sharing this moment, but we all have different pasts. Not one of us has the past of another. And so what we have in this room is a convergence of pasts. And when this meeting is over, we will go our separate ways into a variety of futures. So the assumption that there is one past and one future is just some kind of convenient mental bookkeeping. We are tremendously under the spell of this illusion. I mean, we worry about the future all the time. Well, notice that you could just move to an island somewhere and get a brown-skinned girl, and then you wouldn't have to worry about anybody else's future because you would have made your own future. We can step out of the assumption of a universal history in which we're trapped. And I think realizing this is the beginning of a kind of liberation. Our assumptions are the edges of our worlds. And this is one of our strongest assumptions, the assumptions that there is a past and a future, and our destinies are all caught up in that. But actually, you can, a word that rarely passes my lips, you can deconstruct that assumption, and then you're given back a whole different way of looking at the experience of being, which is empowering. Because somehow, when we are embedded in the future, we feel we have no control whatsoever. We're like corks in a raging river. But in fact, that's a false model, I think. Anybody want to get in on this? And
Terence?
Yeah.
Sometimes when I'm listening to you, I have sort of the troubling thought that I think Terence hasn't done enough psychedelics. Okay. I think that you're too straight in some way. And it's when you get onto some of your scientific tracks, and as you put it, you're a rationalist, I start thinking, why get lost? And I start thinking... I start referring to experiences I have had of being altered, where a lot of this seems incidental to the experience, say, of one experience of eternity, or which I know you've had. And how do you reckon with yourself sometimes and think, when you say doubt yourself and think this is just my ego concocting things to make me feel good, and et cetera, whatever would be the worst case scenario for you. It's hard for me to express this sort of well, but there's something about when you're the way that you often refer to a sort of what seems to be a scientific model that is very linear, even as you talk, you know.
Well, I would certainly agree that I haven't taken enough psychedelics. Reading these people, it seems like... I doubt these guys are real psychedelic heads, and they're much further out than I am. The real truth is, and I've said it many times, that the world is not only stranger than we suppose, it's stranger than we can suppose. And in a way, that's either permission to suppose anything you want, or to just stop supposing. you know. These things are models. The real... nowhere is it writ large that bipedal apes should be able to understand how the universe works. Still less likely is it written anywhere that Terence McKenna should be able to understand how the universe works. Were you here the other night when we talked about the black hole theory of enlightenment? It was two nights ago.
I was here, right?
Yeah. Well, that's the idea that the real truth can't be told. I'm very aware that all of this is just stuff to support me, to make a living, in other words. That in fact what's really going on defies rational apprehension. I hope. I mean, I would hate to think that we could understand what's going on. Nevertheless, there's something to be said for this modeling process. And I agree, I think I'm getting old. You can only push yourself so far. I mean, when I read one of these things today and he was off on some tear, and I just realized, you know, it struck fear in my heart. And I said, my God. You know, and I actually did a mirror, mirror on the wall, who's the weirdest one of all? And it said, Hans Moravec is the weirdest one of all. I said, shit, you know, what am I, you know, I should bring him here and sit at his feet. I don't know, am I talking about what you're talking about? Mm-hmm. Oh, good.
I find a fantastic parallel between the psychedelic experience and physics. I mean, I haven't found anything in the psychedelic experience that would be any problem to relate to from the point of view of a physicist. And actually, I think that all this stuff in physics got out of the bag because of the psychedelic, you know, breakthroughs in the 60s. I mean, Kirchhoff, Kapper, and others had psychedelic experiences and then started to ferret it out from... I mean, in the 1920s, people were puzzling about these things and having the spiritual crises and throwing away all of their assumptions about reality and having these types of breakthroughs, and then it got lost because we started to bag physics to use for the military. And it was only with an environment that opened up because of the psychedelics that it came out.
But I don't think that science, that the purpose of science is to understand reality. This may go to what you're saying. I think the purpose of science is to advance technology, which is a heresy. I don't think reality can be understood, and that it's absolute hubris for science to, you know, cloak itself in the mantle of philosophy. All it's for is to make better toys, or if you're nuts, better weapons. And ultimately, there's not going to be any closure in the effort to understand. And I think that the thing that you take away from psychedelics, finally, is that all models are provisional. That there is no truth. We talked at one point in here about Wittgenstein's phrase, true enough. True enough. True enough to get you to the gas station, true enough to get your taxes paid. But there'll be no closure on this stuff. We have to live in the light of the mystery. But I think we also said in here, you know, it's the death of conversation if we glorify the mystery too much, because then, you know, I'll be just like everybody else here and I'll announce that we're now going to have a meditation, which I've never done to you, I want to point out. Somebody wanted to say...
Well, with that in mind, I wonder how you can project an end to eternity at a certain time.
Well, I didn't mean to imply a nothingness beyond. It isn't like that. I think it's an everythingness. that when I talk about what I envision it as boundary dissolution, if all boundaries dissolve, then, you know, I am you and you are me and we are all together. It's a exfoliation of the human experience. I mean, the great boundaries are, well, no, the small boundaries are man, woman, self, world, and then the big boundaries are life, death, past, future. All of these will be dissolved into something like William Blake's divine imagination, and we will become, you know, our grandest dreams. And so the whole challenge is to dream a dream worthy of that dimension. I mean, it's a very interesting exercise. I don't know if you've ever done it. God, it comes close to being a visualization, I'm sorry to notice. But have you ever played the game, what would I do if I could do anything? First of all, you have to wrap your mind around the concept, anything. What would I do if I could do anything? And I used to think about it in terms, for some reason, for me, it takes the form of an architectural fantasy. You know, first of all, I just locate myself in the house featured in last month's Architectural Digest. Then from there, I would begin to work it out. Well, if you could do anything within a few minutes of entering into that exercise, you're unrecognizable to yourself. I mean, you don't even have to exist in a forward-flowing casuistry of three dimensions. You can be a number of species, and all possible sexes. You can be translocated at many points in time. You begin to realize that you are tremendously limited by your assumptions, and that... And this is sort of what I imagine death is. It's release into the divine imagination. And if you're, you know, blown up in an airliner or something, then immediately after dying, you're just a dead person. But then you begin to unfold and test the boundaries. And, you know, as James Joyce says in Finnegan's Wake, up-niyent prospector, you sprout all your worth and woof your wings. And that's just in the first 30 seconds that you woof your wings. Mm-hmm. And then you are able to assume, to divide your consciousness, to assume any form, to be any place, to know anything. Anything recognizable as human, I think, would quickly drop away or would just become a tiny and familiar touchstone that you would occasionally return to touch. And somehow the dying, which occurs to each one of us, that's the microcosm of the planetary and historical process that we're caught up in. It's the thing that we hate most of all. We fear it. We really get agitated when death is raised as an issue. James Joyce called it the Grim Reaper, a blessing in disguise. If you want to be phoenixed, come and be parked. Meaning, you know, you have to die to fully exfoliate into this dimension. And sometimes I think, and I don't often say it to groups because I fear I'm misunderstood and I don't want people to go out of here depressed, but sometimes I think that what human history pushes for is the extermination of all life on the planet for the simple reason that we'll never be free till then, that we are in some kind of hell world, and we are locked in a world of matter and energy and space and time, and that it is not, you know, my God, this sounds like, Southern Baptists, but we are living death at this moment, and that we must die in order to be born again. In other words, that somehow what we are has become trapped in a lower dimensional matrix, and our greatest delusion is to cling to this most tenaciously. Jorge Luis Borges, in one of his stories, has this idea that the species, any species, is somehow not completed in eternity until the last member of that species dies. And it is interesting that if you think about biology, 95% of all species that have ever lived on this planet are extinct. This is what happens to species, is they go extinct. And yet, you know, we're driven to pursue immortality. It pains us greatly to imagine the death of all life on this planet, and particularly the death of our individual selves or our species. But the fact of the matter is, we don't know what death is. One of the puzzling things about the DMT trance is, you know, these creatures made of light in the mind that are so different from us but have such affection and love for us, they seem like relatives. They seem like, dare we whisper the word, they seem like ancestors. And yet, you know, we would rather believe that they were aliens from Zeta Reticuli or elves in a parallel continuum than apply Occam's razor to the phenomenon and say, since we are the only intelligent entities that we have ever contacted in this universe, these things which we contact in our minds in the center of the DMT flash, they must be human beings of some sort. But they don't look like human beings. But they love us so much and understand us so well. Well, is it possible that the kind of human being they are is a dead human being? That we're actually breaking through into an ecology of souls? I mean, if we say that the psychedelic experience is an experience of boundary dissolution, and if we say that DMT is the strongest of all psychedelics, then may it not be that it is dissolving the most resistant of all barriers, which is the barrier between the living and the dead, and that what you actually come into is the antechambers of eternity for a brief glimpse. If you were to take that rap and properly translate it into Witoto or Muinani or something like that and go to the Amazon and query those folks, they'd say, well, of course. I mean, your own Merciliad tells you that shamanism depends on the spirit ancestors. And for all the credit we give shamanism, we've never actually come to grips with the possibility that shamans really do work with the spirit ancestors, that there really is an ecology of transmaterial human beings in a nearby continuum that can be approached by a boundary dissolving drug. And it's because, you know, we, and certainly I, and certainly proven by this rap tonight, are obsessed with technological explanations of it and how it's going to be the flying saucers, it's going to be the time machine or the collapse of the quantum vector or something like that. But because the forward thrust of our technology is toward immortality. I mean, that's what's gnawing at the back of our minds. And yet what may actually be coming toward us, orthogonal, meaning at right angles to the historical process, is the dissolving of the barrier between the living and the dead, which is so unsettling and mind-boggling to us that we'd take a flying saucer invasion any day over having that happen to us. And yet it's very, very late in the game. You know, human nature is going to have to undergo a radical, vertical translation of some sort if we are to avoid the extinction of ourselves and all life on the planet. Well, so then, you know, maybe that's what it was for. If we believe that we were always embedded in the machinery of nature, that we could never act outside the purposes of nature, then this must be what it's for. It's very interesting in embryology. I think most people think, you know, of a fetus in the womb. As you all know, we begin as very fish-like creatures in the womb, and then out of what are essentially little paddle mitts, the human hand appears. And I think most people think that the tissue retracts tightly and that the human being emerges. But if you've seen fetal stages in bottles in medical schools, what's actually going on is that cells die off. A massive amount of dying goes on in the womb in order that the human form may emerge out of the fetal form. The webbing between the fingers doesn't retract. Those cells die and are released into the amniotic fluid. The growth of the fetus involves the death of millions and millions and millions of cells. So we are born. We are, you could almost say, sculpted into life by the hand of death. I feel as nervous about all this as you must. But, you know, this is what we're here for, right? To stretch the envelope. Yeah.
Terence, I would like to go back to something that you said about the beings of light and the shamanic capacity to see and to interact with these beings, and they could be the ancestors. Thinking in terms of those individuals who refined their senses to being able to see more than the average ability to see and to be able to hear more than just the normal ability to hear, where there's a growing awareness of almost like interpenetrating planes of beings that are actually coexisting with us, but we just can't hear them or see them because we haven't refined those senses enough. And the more psychically sensitive individuals have an increasing ability in a non-drug state to be aware. It's just they can see more and hear more. And I haven't heard you say that.
Well, yeah. I mean, that's a very good point. The perfect example of it in terms of a cultural tradition is fairyland. Fairyland is the pre-Christian Celtic peoples believed that dead souls stayed around in the immediate vicinity, and that there were thousands of them all around, the accumulated dead, very much in the way that when you smoke DMT, then there are thousands of these things, and it raises the question, were they always there, or what's going on? St. Patrick, who brought Christianity to Ireland, found this belief. And also, Anita makes the point about sensitivity. In Irish folklore, there's the idea that if you have the eye, you can see these things, and no drugs are required. It's a psychic ability, which the country Celtic people have sometimes claimed. So when Patrick came to Ireland on his mission of conversion, he found this belief in fairyland so powerfully entrenched in these people that he invented purgatory. Purgatory was invented by St. Patrick to convert the Irish. And then when word was carried back to Rome that Patrick, who was this great bishop of the early church, that he had made this doctrinal concession to Celtic folk thinking, the Pope thought it was such a fine idea that they just wrote it into dogma. So purgatory which, as you all know, is neither heaven nor hell, but a place where you expiate your sins for some amount of time before you pass on to heaven, is nothing less than a cleaned-up version of fairyland written into Christian theology. Now, I don't know why the Celtic people would have not a monopoly, but a firm grip on this. I mean, it may be their innate gloominess, their obsession with death, their it's called the agenbite of Inuit. It's that we just chew on ourselves till we dissolve, but there was something about that character that set it up for perceiving these entities. Although in all traditions all over the world, if you dig deep enough, you can usually find a tradition of small people that live in the hills or under the hills, meaning graves, right, under the hills, and they are the ancestors. And the best that straight folklorists can tell is they have some weird law that as a people recedes into time, they shrink, which seems to me preposterous. I mean, I just don't understand that. I think that the evidence is pretty good that this is going on. The fact that DMT is a naturally occurring neurotransmitter is very suggestive. Rupert Sheldrake has made the suggestion that dying is a unique chemical experience, and he calls DMT a necrotic hallucinogen, that you actually, if you are truly dying, your brain will be flooded with DMT, and then you will see the ecology of souls waiting to receive you. I once questioned a very well-known Tibetan teacher about what was going on in DMT, and he said, yes, these are the lesser lights. He said, you can't, if you go further than that, you will break the thread of connection and be unable to return. And so, you know, I think this is the most challenging idea to us on the conscious and unconscious level, because we may, you know, I mean, I'm only speaking for myself, but it seems to me true that we really have, at a profound level, accepted the scientific lie that death is nonentity. You know, and it's a permanently weakening idea, because it makes us each such a finite being. I mean, it means that no matter what you do, eventually, you know, it will all end in the cold, cold ground. You know, always at my back I hear time's winged chariot hurrying near. This coyness, lady, would be no crime had we but world enough and time. The grave's a lovely private place, but none do there, I think, embrace. Well, maybe Andrew Marvel was wrong. Maybe there's more fun on the other side than you might wish to be congealed. Anybody, save me from myself.
Well, I'm wondering, I have the impression of what comes to mind is a world that you project where everybody is schizophrenic, so that today I can be Napoleon, tomorrow Jesus, and then I can meet somebody else who also believes that he is Napoleon, Jesus, Buddha, or whatever, and back and forth in time. I'm just wondering what kind of a place that's going to be.
Well, I would buy into that. I mean, I think schizophrenia is the absence of cultural expectation. You know, in the most profound sense. I mean, the casuistry doesn't even apply. I mean, I consider myself schizophrenic, and I have observed schizophrenia in other members of my family at close up in great detail. And what it is it's simply the the breakdown of casuistry, and then ordinary people imprisoned in the hallucination of culture, language, and linear time lock you up and put you away because you're reporting from outside the cultural envelope and carrying information that terrifies, alarms, disturbs, and just you drive other people crazy is what it is. I'm talking now about process schizophrenia, which is the spectacular kind where you bring back information that is absolutely incommensurate with the models of your culture. No, I think it's been said that the world is becoming more schizophrenic. Well, that's just because they didn't have the word psychedelic. A psychedelic experience is essentially a kind of schizophrenia, and the people who in the early phase of psychedelic research, they wanted to call it a psychotomimetic, meaning it mimics psychosis. It doesn't mimic psychosis, it's a schizomimetic of some sort. Psychosis is a whole different pathology, but schizophrenia is simply a category for behavior and insight that the rest of society is unable to do anything with, I think. Yeah, no, that doesn't trouble me at all. I like talking about how I'm schizophrenic. Maybe this answers your criticism that I'm linear and running down and old. I can always go nuts. You know, if all else fails, you can go bananas, I suppose. The schizophrenics return with the great aesthetic visions and the scientific breakthroughs and the poetic understandings. I mean, and it's almost as though they have been aided by the demon artificers. They have taken into their retinue supernatural helpers. And a shaman would say, of course, allies. And I'm sure you all know the way in which schizophrenia and shamanism map together. I mean, our own Julian Silverman is the great pioneer in the one-to-one mapping of shamanism and schizophrenia. And years ago, when I was completely bananas, every time they would approach from three sides with nets, I had Julian's paper called Shamanism and Schizophrenia, and I could quote it chapter and verse and back them off because what is called the initiatory crisis in shamanism is nothing more than a schizophrenic break with ordinary reality. The problem is we freak out completely and rush to drug people and give them electroshock and tie them down and slap them around. Well, so then the unfolding of the process is interrupted, and it's as though you were to, you know, perform surgery on a fetus or something and then be amazed when it turns out a monstrosity, when if you would just have left it alone, for crying out loud, it was unfolding along its own creodes of morphological development. This is why people like R.D. Lang seem to me to be the ones who thought most deeply and correctly about schizophrenia. To become schizophrenic is a wonderful, wonderful opportunity. The trick is to make sure that you're nowhere where straight people can get at you. And my schizophrenic episode occurred in the Amazon basin. And, you know, it was 5 days march to just a mission. And I've always felt that evading modern mental health care facilities saved my mind, absolutely. And in a traditional society, it's supported. You know, if someone shows signs because they're dreamy or they hallucinate or they're epileptic or something like that, then this is encouraged and they're put under the care of shamans and drugs are used to initiate the crisis in some cases. And it's a cause for great rejoicing to have these personalities, because in the culture, because they're the antennas for the culture that are contacting the raw stuff of real being and transducing it down into cultural artifacts and institutions that then are useful. Anything else?
Grandfather paradox.
Oh yeah, what did you want to say?
I don't think, your idea of the endpoint makes perfect sense to me, and I don't think the grandfather paradox is an objection. It's not really a paradox.
No, I don't think it's a paradox.
I mean, it's a self-consistent universe. You're here, so you didn't kill your... If you killed your grandfather, you wouldn't be here to ask the question.
I think that's the way to handle that. I think when we finally really understand time travel, we may find out that it's common as dirt and has been going on all around us in all kinds of physical processes.
Make up stories. I mean, the human mind likes to make up stories, so if you came back and killed your grandfather and you're still here, then we'd have to make up a story. Like somebody else got into your grandmother.
But since that isn't how it works.
Well, it may be working that way. I mean people disappear mysteriously and all sorts of things happen, and we just fit them into a framework that makes sense to us. And when we're in a realm of time travel, then maybe we'll have to reinterpret all that weird stuff that occurred in history.
That's an excellent point, that all kinds of stuff goes on around us that may be, in fact, the collapse of paradoxical situations that we don't understand, like, you know, all these well-documented cases of spontaneous human combustion and stuff like that. I mean, unless you just flat-out deny that this goes on, which is a kind of cop-out, I think, because it just means you don't believe large bodies of evidence. I mean, not everything weird that's claimed goes on. But on the other hand, I don't think God is a Republican. I think there's plenty of weird shit flying around. And as I said, nowhere is it writ that anthropoid apes should understand reality. And every culture that's ever existed has operated under the illusion that it understood 95% of reality and that the other 5% would be delivered in the next 18 months. And from Egypt forward, they've been running around believing they had a perfect grip on things. And yet, we look back at every society that preceded us with great smugness at how naive they all were. Well, it never occurs to us then that maybe we're whistling in the dark too. That the universe is stranger than you can suppose, and that openness that perception imparts is a great joy, a great blessing, because then you can live your life not in service to some fascistic metaphor, but in service to the living mystery. The fact that you're not going to understand it. It is not going to yield to logic or magic or any other technique that's been developed. It's bigger, you know, the novelist John Crowley has this wonderful aphorism, the further in you go, the bigger it gets. And I think this is true of most things. That's all, folks. We got through another one of these. Okay, thank you all for coming. I do not understand why you put up with this. But I appreciate it. I do appreciate it.